So today we'll be talking to Aditya Jagdap, who is a professional squash player. He is a top squash player who's ranked number 7 in India. He has graduated from Cornell University. So Aditya, why don't you tell us about your time at Cornell?
Firstly, hi. Thanks for having me on your YouTube channel. I honestly had a great time there. I didn't know what to expect because now it's a big thing. Like about 50 to 80% of all Indian squash players go to university. But my time, there weren't that many Indian squash players in the Ivy League. Like I knew Naisha Lalwani, Alisha Mashruwala, to name a few, but there were very few basically, So it was Ramit Tandon, who I think you heard of as well, and me. Like Ramit went to Columbia, I went to Cornell. So we were the two from that year who ended up going to the Ivy League. So yeah, actually, I had a bit of an idea because I went to England for boarding school in Millfield. So sort of accustomed to the Western culture, I guess. But still, yeah, it was a great experience. I met it. Cornell's very diverse, and if you don't know where it is, it's sort of in the middle of nowhere. In Ithaca, it's sort of on top of a valley. It's absolutely gorgeous. And yeah, it's a big school. It's a lot of diversity, a lot of space, a lot of beauty, a lot of scenery. And yeah, I had a great time, to be honest. Just for me being a part of that sort of setup where we had so much support, so much love from our teachers, so many like options and opportunities, because I went in not knowing what I wanted to study. That's one good thing about US is like your first year, they let you experiment and take a whole bunch of classes and figure out sort of, you don't have to declare a major at Cornell until you're 2 years in, actually. So for me, that was great. It gave me a lot of time to figure out what I wanted, to do exactly. So yeah.
Great. So how are you able to balance out squash and academics at Cornell?
So I think firstly, obviously, I think the way you pick your classes is very important. The easiest thing to do is not fall behind on your average number of credits, because a lot of people they like to start slow, but then the credits pile up later, right? So you have a certain number of credits that you have to finish to graduate. So you have to sort of divide it properly and organize your schedule really well. Like your time management plays a big role, because while the other kids are in class till like 2, 3, and then they have from 4 to like 9 or 10 to like rest and study and do the thing. For athletes, we finish at 2, 3, and then 5 to 7 or 6 to 8, we have training. Then after training, you're really tired, and then you still have to figure out to do your readings, to do your homework, to prepare for your prelim. So we get a lot less time. Also, for non-athletes, even if they take chill out during the week, like Friday, Saturday, Sunday, they get to do and catch up on their work, right? For athletes, we're always traveling. We either have home games or away games, so we could go an entire Friday, Saturday, Sunday without getting any time to touch our books. So yeah, time management is key, and I struggled, to be honest with you, like my freshman year. But I guess as I went through the system and I learned out little tricks and made sure I'm on top of my work and had like a diary where I put everything out, had like a whiteboard where I wrote my tasks for the day, So just yeah, I think it's being organized and keeping on top of things, because very easy to fall behind, and once you fall behind, you just feel like you're never going to catch up. So yeah, that's one thing.
Okay, so did you directly move into professional squash after studying at Cornell?
No, so after Cornell, I actually worked for 2 years. My first year, I was working with this company called Seedfire. And then after that, I moved on to another recruiting, squash recruiting firm called the Osman Group. But unfortunately, I don't know if you know how the system works, but the H-1B visa goes through a lottery. And I didn't get in on my lottery. So I ended up coming back. And my parents have a pharmaceutical business here, so I was working with my parents in pharmaceutical, in my as well as I started this not company, but this sort of group with one of my friends from Cornell, which helps recruit at Indian athletes, Indian like squash players to the Ivy League and other colleges who want them. So I was doing both those things, and basically, with parents' business, I just realized that I was 25 years old, and this is what I was going to be doing my whole life. So that was a little scary for me, like I wanted to try something and experience other things before I moved back into my parents' business. So obviously squash was an option, and at that time at Cornell, David Palmer had just taken over, so he was the head coach there. So I thought, it's a good opportunity for me to give it a go. And my old so I went to school with the Shorbagi brothers, so the older Shorbagi had just started training with David. So I thought, why not, let's just give it a couple of months, not really expecting too much out of it, let's just go and see how it works. So I went there and I trained with them for a few months and played my first tournament and then sort of got hooked onto it. And then for the last 3 years, before Corona struck, I was playing pro full time. Yeah.
Okay, that's great. So what advice would you give students who want to become professional squash players?
So I think it's obviously not that easy because what happens is some people go pro straight out of juniors, right? So they obviously always have 3, 4, 5 years on you, right? Once you go to college, whether you like it or not, you're not training that pro level, you know, because you're studying, you have your friends, you have your social life, you have your exams, and then you have squash, right? And also in squash, the season gets over in Feb. So from Feb to August until the next season starts, you're not really, you're working, but it's all your own work, right? You don't really have the sort of support system of your coaches or those sort of players. While people who've gone pro straight away have that and they've been doing that for 4 or 5 years. So I would say it's obviously a lot of catching up. But I think there are enough players right now in the top 100, top 80 in the world. I'm 66, 67 right now. So we've proven that it can be done. You know, you can go spend 4 years in college and still manage to have a decent career out of it. You know, Ali Farag, who was actually the world number one, he went to Harvard for 3, 4 years and then he... So, you know, I think it can be done now. But I think about 8 to 10 years ago, that wasn't a thing that just could be done. But now I think even... before, you saw people were peaking in like 28, 29, but now people are peaking in 32, 33, 34. So I think now you have a lot more time to sort of, with the new sports medicine and just the way we, our diet and the way we look after our bodies, I feel like, yeah, even after you graduate, you still could have 10, 12 good years to sort of really enjoy the sport at a high level. So I would say keep going. Like, you know, when you're in college, like enjoy that. It shouldn't be like when you're in college, you're constantly thinking about pro and not making use of that experience, you know. So keep training, be fit, and enjoy that college experience. Because after you're done, you'll still have a lot of time to, you know, get back into pro. Like for me, I finished college, I worked for 2, 2.5 years, then I restarted. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you so much for your time, and I wish you all the very best.
Thanks a lot, buddy.